My name is Daniela Rus. I'm the director of the Computer Science and Artificial Intelligence Laboratory at MIT, the place where the future of computing takes flight. Our laboratory has deep roots in two powerhouses, the AI lab and the laboratory for computer science. Now, we have a lot of projects at CSAIL in a lot of different areas, but today we are going to focus on our machine friends. Let's go take a look. Hello, Joseph. What are you working on today?
Hi, Daniela. I've been working on some of our wearables for interacting with robots and with other animals.
Why do we want wearables to interact with robots and animals?
So we want to make it easier for anyone to interact with robots. And you know, right now it can be a little hard to learn the robot's language. But if we could just use someone's natural muscle signals or even their motion or brain signals, then it could be a lot more intuitive.
So what does Stretch do today?
So Stretch is responding to a lot of the gestures that I'm making based on a neural network processing my muscle signals.
So can you make Stretch shake hands with me?
So if I squeeze my fist, then Stretch will close its gripper.
What are we going to use these intuitive motions for?
I always wanted a robot to help me around the kitchen, actually.
So, like a sous chef.
Exactly. So we've been using a lot of wearables to record how people do kitchen tasks, so like peeling cucumbers, slicing potatoes, or setting the table. And then hopefully the robot can learn from those demonstrations and those interactions.
So what else are you working on?
This is actually a device that we've been developing along with Rob Wood's lab at Harvard. And it allows us to probe the mysteries of how whales actually communicate and learn more about their culture. This is placed on a whale and holds on using suction cups. And then it has a lot of different sensors. It has underwater microphones. It has depth sensors, temperature sensors, motion sensors, and maybe even biosignal sensors that we've been looking at adding. And this allows us to get a great multimodal view of how the whale is behaving. And hopefully we can build up a data set that lets us understand more about their language and their culture.
How do you collect this data? How do you attach the tag onto the whale?
Yeah, so we go out and we listen for the whales using microphones to find them. And then we go and attach the tag to the whale, either using a long pole or using drones. And we try to be as gentle and as minimally invasive as possible so the whales don't really notice it. We actually had a recent expedition where we got to be really close to the whales, and we were lucky enough to even see a whale giving birth.
That's amazing. Can you show?
Yeah, we actually had a lot of drones in the air. We had microphones underwater and people on the boat. We were all recording this amazing event. And this is an example of where I synchronized all the different devices so you can see it from many different angles and get all of the different data we recorded. So we have drone footage showing it from up above. We have all our cameras from the boat. We have the audio recordings as well as the GPS positions. So this will hopefully allow us to learn more about how they approach this multi-species event and celebration.
Studying artificial intelligence and robotics is teaching us a lot, not just about the technology, but also about ourselves, about life, and about this wonderful place we get to live on, the place Carl Sagan used to call the pale blue dot. Let's go check out some modular robotic cubes. This way. Hi, John.
Hi, Daniela.
How are you today?
Doing pretty well.
And how is Belty doing today?
So Belty is doing pretty good. He wants to show you a demo where he picks up and relocates a block. And you can sort of imagine this as like industrial Legos, so that you could have factories and buildings that sort of reconfigure themselves.
Wow, that was amazing.
So now he's trying to interface with a different robot to drop off this block.
John, that's really very cool, but why would we want to do this?
Our current industrial system is not very flexible, scalable, and when we have disruptions like the pandemic or other disruptions, basically, we can't respond fast enough to them. And having factories modular should help make that more effective.
So response basically means making all the products that we need at the time we need them. And with this system, we can begin to imagine factories that have self-reconfiguring gantries, where the gantries will automatically adapt to the production need. Right now, it takes a long time to reconfigure and redesign gantry systems. With this approach, we will have much more agile factories. John, and where do we go from here?
I think my next step is, after graduating, is to try to figure out a way to potentially open source this idea and get multiple researchers working together to create sort of the the specifications for modular factories.
Graduation is soon, right?
Yes. Graduation is about a month. I have a lot of hard work ahead of me.
Well, I look forward to seeing Belty's feats in a month's time.
Thank you.
Let's go see what's happening at the Robot Locomotion Lab. Come on over. Hi, Russ.
Hi, Daniela. Welcome to the Robot Locomotion Group.
What are you working on today?
Well, we've got robots all around you. We've been doing a lot of things over the years. We do flying robots, as you know. We do humanoid robots. But these days, we're making robots play with their hands.
Amazing. Tell me more.
The world's changing. We have big generative AI. And now we're trying to make sure we understand how to make generative AI work for robots with hands.
You mean you're studying the interaction aspect of intelligence?
Yeah. And there's big questions. We don't really know how much data it's going to be required to feed this. We don't know where we're going to get the data. So we have a couple bets. One of them is to bet on simulation plus some really good control design and simulation.
Amazing. Can we see some demos?
We have a bimanual robot, which means two arms, working with two hands and doing some complicated motion planning. And then I'll show you something else on a quadruped. And these are examples of really good plans that we can make slowly, but generate a lot of data and feed a data pipeline.
I'm so excited to see this integration of language, perception, and control, which are the hallmarks of intelligence.
I agree. This here is a bimanual setup I was telling you about. Having two robots work in perfect harmony and doing complex motions in and out of obstacles is still a hard problem. Tommy here has been really making a lot of progress on that, and he's going to tell you a little bit about our new experiment.
If you're holding an object, you've sort of fixed your hands together. So anytime you move one of the arms, the other has to move perfectly to stay in sync. Or you'll drop the object, or if it's fragile, you might break it. So we've been working on some code that allows us to control and plan for the robot arms in a very precise way so as to accomplish that. So as you can see here, we're going to move each of the joints individually in that left arm. And then the right arm has to take very complicated motions in order to maintain that constraint.
So this part isn't the end goal. This is just showing you that we've got the math right and understand how to work with the hands perfectly in sync.
In the last bit here, we can even move one of the arms without moving its hand at all.
Okay, now we want to show you the real demo here where we put some shelves up in front of the robot and make it a little bit more crowded so the robot has to figure it out.
The new planning framework we're using is something called Graph of Convex Sets. One of the benefits it gives us is we can get very strong collision-free guarantees. So we know the robot's not going to bump into anything. Normally, we're a little uneasy to bring the robots this close to obstacles, but we're so confident in the methodology we're using here that we're willing to cut it really close. And as it's doing this, you can see that it's really maintaining the distance and the orientation between its hands.
This is our spot robot from Boston Dynamics here. We showed you a little bit about how we're doing advanced motion planning with two arms attached to a table. But we've been working hard now on trying to get a mobile manipulator, a legged robot here, to do the same kind of beautiful motion plans, but use its entire body. So let me put this down here on the robot and see if you can get Spot to pick it up, David.
In the following motion, we will have GCS plan and 25 dimensions to move back, grab the little robot and try to place it between its legs.
Sounds great.
Let's do it.
Why do we care so much about doing whole body motion planning on a quadruped here?
Previously, many quadrupeds came without arms, so they do purely locomotion and don't do much manipulation in the real world. On stationary robots, we do care about collision-free motion planning and generating fast and good-looking trajectories, and I think it is time to combine both of that so we can do mobile manipulation and have a useful robot not only somewhere mounted on a desk, but traverse through an arbitrary environment and help in other places.
Yeah, this robot is great. This can walk all over campus, and now we're going to make it so it can manipulate objects wherever it goes.
Let's see it move a little bit.
Looks good. Let's do it.
Hey, Gabe.
Hi, Daniela.
What are you working on, and who's your new friend?
In the Improbable AI Lab here, we've been working on different combinations of locomotion and manipulation. previously we were working on Dribblebot, which is a soccer playing robot. And now we're really interested in sort of what happens if we take this quadruped and we mount an arm on the top.
So what's the difference between this one and Dribblebot?
This robot is a lot bigger, and the reason for its large size is so it can support the arm, which is heavier. But the advantage that we'll have from using the arm is that we can actually do some interesting manipulation. So instead of just kicking objects with its feet, the robot can walk around and touch objects, which will be useful in lots of environments like a kitchen where we need it to accomplish some manipulation tasks.
Can it move the objects around? Can it plan for how to organize your kitchen?
Right now, we're really focusing on the low-level controls of the robot. So how can the walking and grasping be coordinated? For example, if the robot needs to reach up to a really high cabinet, it might actually have to stretch its legs or even move a small object to step up on top of it in order to reach up to that cabinet.
So it's learning some gymnastics.
Yeah, in a sense.
Can we see?
Yeah, we can do a little motion around. It's actually operated by a virtual reality headset. And so our operator will move that arm around a little bit.
Oh, it's wanting to dance or stretch or something.
You can see that if it wants to reach low to the ground, it kind of needs to bend its legs down.
Yeah, it's very interesting. The control is very smooth.
Because of the learning-based approach that we use, it can avoid some of the like singularities that you might get when the arm is outstretched all that way. What we're really building, I think, is a teleoperation interface for providing demonstrations. And the challenge, of course, is that with such a large robot with high degrees of freedom, the human operator might have a hard time telling the robot exactly what it should do in every scenario.
Well, Gabe, you know that upstairs we have a kitchen where we're studying how humans perform the kind of prep tasks that are needed in cooking. And perhaps we can get the robot to be a sous chef for our human chefs.
Definitely. I think in a few months we should bring them up and give it a try.
Gabe, that was so awesome. Thank you so much for showing us your new friend. And I really look forward to seeing it in the kitchen helping us.
Thank you. Looking forward to it too.
All right. Have a nice day. Bye-bye. Thank you for joining us to meet our machine friends at CSAIL. See you on the next tour.